بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Our religion is based on three principles, and we are required to have at least the minimum knowledge about these aspects. The first one is Tawheed, and this specifically refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the only deity worthy of worship. It has three elements that are inseparable within Tawheed. First one, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, sustainer of everything, and that the destiny of everything is known to Him, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, the past, present, and the future. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also is the one who keeps everything alive and according to the destiny that He has decided for them. The second aspect is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the most beautiful names and attributes. And that these names and attributes are not only 99 as some people think. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us some of His names and attributes, but some of them He still kept with Him. According to the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his dua, where he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by every name he had, that name, whether that name he taught it to some of his slaves, servants or prophets or messengers, revealed in his books or kept in the knowledge of the unseen with him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many other names that we don't know of. These names and attributes describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no book in existence that describes Allah even a fraction similar to what the Quran talks about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Him, His names and attributes, His warnings and promises, the past, the present, the future, the news of all these three that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent forth in His book. And the last element is because element number one and two lead us definitely to element number three, and that is Allah is the only deity worthy of worship. No person or object that deserves to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is Tawheed, and many people think that these are statements that some people came with, but that's not true. Every single aspect I just mentioned is found in numerous places in the Quran and by the words of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second aspect is about ittiba', and ittiba' means to obey and follow. And it is specifically about our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are things that, or aspects that are understood or found within this concept, which is al-ittiba'. That our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our only Rasul, meaning sent to us. We believe in all the prophets of Allah, from Adam alayhi salam to Muhammad alayhi salam. But our Rasul in specific is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because of that, we don't take legislation from any other Rasul. If there are elements, and there are elements in our religion that are similar to what the prophets before him came with, it's because our religion affirmed it. That's why we believe in those, we follow those. For example, the law of al-rajm for the adulterer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this law down to Musa alayhi salam. So he's the one who established it for all Muslims after him. But our religion came and affirmed it, and this is why it is a part of our legislation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this religion, the religion of Islam, similar in the aspect of Tawheed and faith to every religion or every revelation that came to the prophets before our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the same thing. There's no difference. And you can still find traces of this even in the books of the people that they have, which they changed many, many, many times. They still have traces of Tawheed. But with regards to the legislation, there were differences between a prophet and another. For example, the prophet before our prophet, alayhi salam, who came with a complete way of life, is Musa, alayhi salam. From Musa until Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, many prophets came, but they all followed the law of Musa, alayhi salam, including Isa, alayhi salam. He came basically to follow the law of Musa, alayhi salam, with some additions and deletions that every prophet was sent with. But mainly, the legislation was the legislation sent to Musa alayhi salam until our Rasul sallallahu alayhi salam came. It abrogated everything that came before it and became dominant above it. Dominant in that, yes, Musa alayhi salam started the law of al-rajm, for example, but our Rasul is a higher ranking Rasul. And therefore, when he affirmed the law of al-rajm, it became as a dominant thing that Rasulullah ﷺ affirmed it, being the higher ranking Rasul and Prophet above even Musa alayhi salam. This is why when our Rasul ﷺ saw Umar al-Khattab once reading in a copy of the Torah, he became very angry. And Umar realized the mistake he made. And this is why he fell to his knees and said a statement that is a very powerful statement. رضينا بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا. Umar said, I accept, I'm pleased with, I'm announcing that Allah is my only Rabb, Islam is my religion, and Muhammad is my Rasul. He understood. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم gave him a very powerful statement, saying to him that even if Musa عليه السلام were alive, he would have no choice but to follow the law of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because that was the prophet for all people. And his religion will remain until the end of time. Therefore, the aspect of Tawheed in it is the aspect of Tawheed. The aspect of legislation is different, is dominant above the religion or the legislation that came to the prophets before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is a hadith in Sahih Muslim that's very important too. That hadith says, كَيْفَ أَنْتُمْ إِذَا نَزَلَ فِيكُمُ ابْنُ مَرْيَمَ فَأَمَّكُمْ مِنْكُمْ. The hadith says, how would be your situation if Isa ibn Maryam descends among you and أَمَّكُمْ مِنْكُمْ. Now, one of the narrators of hadith asked his teacher, he said, the hadith that came to us is وَإِمَامُكُمْ مِنْكُمْ. Your imam would be one of you. Because the hadith says that Isa alayhi salam will allow al-Mahdi to become the leader of the Salah, because Isa alayhi salam, you know, he wasn't the leader of the particular Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would be, of course, later on. But he said, one of you will be imams above the rest of you. But this hadith says, فَأَمَّكُمْ مِنْكُمْ. Imama, we know what imama means, to lead. So the teacher said to the student, do you want me to tell you about the meaning of it? He said, yes. He said, he will rule you according to the book of your Lord and to the sunnah of your Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Isa alayhi salam, when he comes back, he's going to rule by the Quran and the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's not going to rule by his own law. Why? Because now he's under the same thing as our statement. If Musa were to be alive today, he will have no choice but to follow me. Isa will be alive during the time of the Ummah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he will only follow the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then people can't argue with Isa alayhi salam and say, my madhab is this, my sheikh is that, because you better believe that he's receiving the information about the Sunnah from Allah. But some people, of course, because of their whatever it is that they created for themselves, from following the madhab and this and that, they say that when Isa alayhi salam will come, he will follow the madhab of Abu Hanifa. No, he's not going to follow the madhab of Abu Hanifa. All those who are better than Abu Hanifa, and Abu Hanifa, of course, was a major scholar of Islam. He never said anything to that effect in any way or form. And I doubt Abu Hanifa would agree to it in any way or form. No, he would rule by the Sunnah of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore, when we talk about al-ittiba' now, you have the perspective of ittiba'. Ittiba' means that I follow the Rasul that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to me. I believe in all the prophets and the messengers, but he's the one who gives me legislation. But he's the one who gives me legislation from Allah by permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, I don't follow any sunnah except the sunnah of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this leads us to another question. If this is the case between the sunnah as compared to Musa and Isa alayhim as-salam, do you think there's going to be even comparison between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and any sheikh who comes after him? You can't even compare. This is why we tell people to realize the fact that the sunnah is dominant above the sunnah of Musa alayhi salam and Isa alayhi salam. So how do you think that somebody who came after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who has to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, can actually compete with the sunnah? That sometimes you follow this one or the sunnah. No, it doesn't happen. This is why we want to reintroduce the sunnah into the life of Muslims. Let them know that the sunnah is dominant and above any legislation, any school of thought, that you have no choice but to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that your mission in life is to seek out the legislation that came from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his commandments, how he practiced the religion, his orders, the sunnah, all type. Don't only look for the sunnah that is wajib, as some people do, and then they don't care much about the sunnah that is not required. No, all type of sunnah is above any thought of anyone before or after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before, it's for people, of course, you know, every prophet who came to an ummah, that ummah had to follow that prophet in the legislation. The prophet, like Musa alayhi salam, in his time, people had to say La ilaha illallah, Musa, Rasulullah. La ilaha illallah, Isa, Rasulullah. When it came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad Rasulullah, because he was sent with the legislation that is dominant, we follow his sunnah only. We don't follow the sunnah of the prophets before him, even though we love them. And we believe that any prophet is better than any other human being who is not a prophet, including Abu Bakr and everybody else. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this very clear to us. Our ittiba' is for our Rasul. And our Rasul is the best Rasul. His sunnah is the best sunnah. His legislation is the best legislation. And therefore, for people to think that I would like, you know, to do this and that, maybe, you know, what my sheikh said maybe sometimes is better than, you know, that or whatever, you tell them a sunnah, they argue about it or against it. This is really not good, because Musa alayhi salam, being a prophet and a messenger from Allah, a mighty prophet, didn't have the truth. How do you think you have the truth? Especially when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It's not up to a believer, male or female, that when Allah and His Messenger make a decision, that they should have the choice or the option in that decision. Meaning, well, it's up to me to decide, I can take it, I'll not take it. This is really something that really held the Ummah down in the past few centuries. We did not progress in religion much for centuries. And as a consequence, we did not progress much even in life in the past few centuries. Because they are connected in our case. For those who don't believe, if they seek the life, Allah gives them the life. And gives them something nice, they beautify their cities, their lands, their streets, their houses. That, you know, if you look at it, they think this is their Jannah. They don't think there is anything beyond that. So they make it this Jannah. But in our case, if we are good Muslims, we receive aid from Allah, we become a mighty nation. If we're not good Muslims, we receive consequences for our behavior as much as the difference between obedience and disobedience. And therefore, go back to al-ittiba'. Al-ittiba' is a natural consequence of al-tawheed. Because you declare you only worship Allah, and Allah only sent to me Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, therefore I have that concept of al-ittiba'. He's the only man I follow in the religion in every aspect. Every other man, I follow them according to their obedience to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abu Bakr, we love Abu Bakr, consider him the best Muslim after our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because he was his cousin? Yes, he was his distant cousin. But not only, it's not because of that. Abu Lahab was the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the only man mentioned from the people of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by name and giving the news that he's going to Jahannam. So it's not about that. Abu Bakr wasn't closer in relation to the Prophet ﷺ than Abu Lahab. Why? Because of his obedience to Rasulullah ﷺ. Because every time Rasulullah called him to something, he said, yes. And he mentioned it. He said, Rasulullah ﷺ, that each of you, whenever I called you, there was hesitation, except for Abu Bakr. And when the people came to him and said, did you hear your man, your fellow say what he said? Or did you hear what your fellow said? He said, what? What did he say? They said, he said that last night, Allah took him from his bed to Al-Quds, to heaven, back to his bed, and all within one night. He said that it is the truth. Look at this. He said, I believe in better than this. I believe in the commandment from Allah coming from heaven to earth with no time. So what about a whole night? You see what I'm saying? That's the logic that he gave. I believe in better than that. That the legislation, the commandment, the Quran, the revelation comes from Allah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No time. In no time. So what about what you're saying? From that day, and this is an authentic hadith, he was called As-Siddiq. So now for Al-Tiba', we look at this Al-Tiba' as the natural consequence of Tawheed. As a natural consequence of Tawheed. Therefore, these two come together. You can't separate them. You say La ilaha illallah, you have to say Muhammad Rasulullah. If you say Muhammad Rasulullah, he will be the only source for you for legislation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وبعد. The third aspect we want to talk about, the third aspect we want to talk about inshallah ta'ala today is called التزكية. تزكية means to purify yourself. To purify yourself from the impurity of shirk, all kinds of deviant behavior and ideas, from disobedience to the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore, a tazkiyah here is the consequence of a tawheed and al ittiba'. When you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His words, you believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and His commandments, you take these aspects and you fill your heart and limbs with them. And therefore, as the scholars before said, that our faith, iman, is a creed, meaning the heart, a statement, and in action, it comes to a tazkiyah to prove all three. Now you receive the information about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the day to come, about the news about al-ghayb, about me, myself, and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to me personally from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that I can go bi'idhnillah to Jannah and earn His mercy. And this goes for all of mankind. That information that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends in His Quran, His description, the things that you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Himself in the Quran is so wonderful that people before us who had faith, they would cry when they hear these things. They would cry when they hear the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let alone about His names and attributes. So when you read about the description of the faith, now you put it in your heart. You import it, you put it in your heart and you leave it there. It will have to show its effect. And the effect is outward. You say, from here, La ilaha illallah. So the statement confirms with the heart. And when you say La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, you start learning your religion. And for Allah's sake, you practice it. One aspect, two aspects, three, four, five, six, until you finish, mashallah ta'ala, your life learning, and you cannot learn the entire religion in a lifetime, because it's so vast. But Allah doesn't want you, or if we are not required, which is the better statement, we are not required to know everything in the religion. It's a process. It goes from one day to another, from one week to another, until you end your life. So if you take all these aspects and put them in your life, they have to be manifested in the creed that resides in your heart, and therefore there is always here tawheed and also rejection of shirk, minor or major. You're always struggling against, you know, the ideas, the practices. You reject them, throw them away, so that you keep the purity of tawheed in your heart. Because the heart has no place for shirk and iman together, one or the other. We're not talking about minor shirk that people may fall to. We are talking about shirk as compared to tawheed. You can't have both in the heart. If you have both in the heart, shirk will invalidate the iman. So you have to have iman. It has to be pure. And secondly, if you say, I love Allah, I love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but I'm not going to practice anything in the religion, where is the proof for your statement, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah? Where is the proof? You have to say it first to become Muslim. Abu Talib, he said in a poem collected by Imam Bukhari, that the best religion there is the religion of Muhammad. It's in Bukhari. Now when he was dying, having said that, when he was dying, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rushed to his bedside, and there were Abu Jahl and other leaders of Quraysh, and there was a competition now. The leaders of Quraysh telling Abu Talib something, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling him, say la ilaha illallah, that I may testify for you because of it with Allah on the Day of Judgment. And the people of Quraysh telling him, the leaders, are you going to abandon the religion of Abdul Muttalib? The competition. Before he said the best religion there is, not the religion of Abdul Muttalib, but the religion of Muhammad. Now, the competition, the last moment in his life, he says, I follow the religion of Abdul Muttalib. And therefore, the statement that didn't come out of his mouth condemned him to hellfire for eternity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his punishment there lighter because of his support of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But out of arrogance, he wouldn't say la ilaha illallah, but he believed it in here. So there is a connection here between the outward and the inward. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. Muhammadur Rasulullah, ittiba. And then I start learning the religion, and then I start learning the religion aspect by aspect and practicing it. And this is a tazkiyah. Tazkiyah is faith, statement, and action. And I take all the aspects of the religion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and change my life accordingly. And if I change my life accordingly, then I become a believer bi'idhnillahi azza wa jal. My level will be according to as much faith and obedience I give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is my level. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was describing the level Abu Bakr and Umar had in Jannah above the believers. And the Sahaba asked him a very important question. Where will we be then, O Rasulullah? On that day, where will we be? He said, Antum حَيْثُ جَعَلْتُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ. You will be where you place yourself. You see, this is Sahaba. Where will we be then? You spoke about Abu Bakr and Umar, they're eager about themselves. What about us? You will be where you place yourself. So, all of us in the religion, we will be on the day to come where we place ourselves in Islam in this life. According to the Tawheed and the Ittiba' and taking these two to become the purifier of my actions, statements, behavior, ideas, everything that has to do with me. And this is the true meaning for Islam being a complete way of life, because it is a complete way of life. It's not only something that resides in the heart. We had discussions with some people of the book who would say, God knows I have faith. Why should I pray? I said, but He's telling you to pray. So you don't have a faith because you're disobeying Him. I'm telling him like this, if you have a son and you're sick, you can't go to the kitchen to get some water, and you tell your son, I want to take some medicine, bring me a cup of water. And your son says, I love you, my father, very much. You brought me up, you spent on me, this and that, took care of me. Go get it yourself. I'm not going to do it. Do you think any of us would agree to that? Absolutely not. Allah did far more than this father did for his son, his son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. Everything we have is from him. So he tells you to have faith. I have faith. Obey me. No, I'm not going to do it. Why? Because you know the heart has faith in you, but you haven't manifested it. You didn't practice it. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us knowledge in the religion. Brothers, this understanding is very important. This is why bi'idhnillah azza wa jal, we will teach these aspects and many, many other aspects, inshaAllah, in this center. Our goal here is to establish a school. The Medina Educational Institute is a school. We want it to be different from the setup that the masajid have. Meaning what? It's not a social gathering. It's not for men to come and talk about whatever it is that has nothing to do with the religion and not really listening that much to the classes or practicing. Or for families to come so that women can see each other and talk about what they didn't talk about since last Friday. It's not a social gathering, it's not a social club. It's for people who are serious about the religion, who want to learn the religion and practice it. Because death is just around the corner. In our lifetime, millions, hundreds of millions of people died. They died already. So what do you think, we're going to last forever? No, hundreds of millions of people died in this boy's lifetime. So it is a very serious matter. You die, you can't come back. And then people who go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they did good, like that man, the Sahabi who died as a shaheed, he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, send me back to this life so I can die again in your sake. Because of the honor he saw with Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him that I decided they will not go back to it, to life. Those who did ill and wickedness, they say, oh Allah, send us back, we will change our situation and our behavior. And Allah says no, because that's it. Also Allah will say to those people, Allah will say to these people who asked to come back, having done wickedness in this life, وَلَوْ رُدُّوا لَعَادُوا لِمَا نُهُوا عَنْهُ. If they were sent back, they will still do the same thing they did before. Because wickedness originates from here. Therefore, if you say now you're caught, the punishment is there, you can see it, or one can see it. If someone says, I want to go back, I'm going to change my behavior, Allah knows me, knows here, that if I go back to this life for 10,000 years, I'm not going to change. Why? Because wickedness or righteousness, they both originate from the heart. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us knowledgeable. Wa aqim as-salah.
والذين يبيتون لربهم سجدا وقياما والذين يقولون ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب جهنم إن عذابها كان غراما